The found footage genre is a genre that often is either loved or hated. And the genre has offered some movies that have been great and some that have been total failures. The one that popularized the genre is also one that half of the horror community hates, and half of it thinks it's one of the best horror movies ever made. I belong to the latter group. I'm of course talking about The Blair Witch Project. This movie managed things that not many other found footage horror movies have done, except for maybe the first Paranormal Activity movie, and that is to actually frighten. My first time watching this movie was when I was about 12 or 13, and I was up one later night laying down on the sofa, and when this movie started, I was totally swept away by its story, style, and world building that it spread out in tidbits throughout the whole movie. The Blair Witch is a very underrated and often unfairly criticized movie, and with this video I will explain why. The marketing of The Blair Witch from 1999 was one of a kind and genius. You had these three unknown actors that used their real names in the marketing for the movie. Private pictures of them and their real names was used in missing posters for them. The actors using their real names instead of character names made it seem like these are real people that went missing in the woods. There were websites that got made, and remember when this movie was released, the internet was something quite new. You didn't get constant information about movies or set pictures or anything like that. And in those websites you could get clues about the movie and different kind of clips from the movie. The cast members even had people call their relatives and family to offer their condolences. It was a marketing style that had never been done before, and it worked very well to get people in the theaters to see The Blair Witch. Now, when you think about the marketing of the movie, it could have easily have been figured out with some logical thinking applied. The fact that the whole movie was shot by the missing people that appear in the movie, and that there was some incriminating things that happened in the movie, is something that police would never sell to a movie studio or let it be released in movie theaters. It's evidence material, so it would have never been shown in a public matter like this. I mean, when you think about it, you are watching people that went missing or possibly got killed in the woods in the theater as entertainment, and tickets are being sold. So the movie would have easily been disproved if you were thinking a bit further about it. But overall, it was a genius move by the studio to market it the way they did. The movie became a big hit in the late 90s, and from a budget of $60,000, the movie made $250 million worldwide. So there is no doubt that it was a big win for the studio Lionsgate. In October 1994, Heather, Josh, and Mike go out to the Black Hills Forest in Burkittsville, Maryland, to shoot a documentary about the Blair Witch myth. The locals tell them Rustin Parr murdered children in the 1940s. He murdered them all in his basement, killing them in twos, while having one stand in the corner and watch. The students explore the forest in North Burkittsville to research the myth. They meet two fishermen, one of whom warns them that the forest is cursed. He tells them of a young child named Robin Weaver, who went missing in 1988. When she returned 3 days later, she talked about an old woman whose feet never touched the ground.
Something about an old woman whose feet never touched the ground.
I tell you, I saw right up there by that tree, up the creek. I told you that.
Right, I know.
At 100 yards, I saw a white, misty thing that I can't tell what it is.
It was like a gray vapor rising out of the trees?
Right out of the water.
Right out of the water?
Up the side of the tree, and it disappeared over them.
Oh, you're full of it.
Yeah, I'm not full of it.
So
I was drinking that day.
How is that related to the story of Coffin Rock?
It all ties into the story of Coffin Rock.
How's that?
I mean, anybody, or if they're salt around here, knows that this area has been haunted by that old woman for years.
That's bullshit.
The students hiked to Coffin Rock, where five men were found ritualistically slaughtered in the 19th century. Their corpses later vanished. They camped for the night, and what follows from here is that the next morning they found seven small cairns at an old graveyard that Josh accidentally knocks one over.
What's this?
Whoa!
What is this? Dude, guys, do you remember something that Mary Brown said the other day? What was the story from the Bible that she was telling us? Fuck, I wasn't listening to her because I thought she was a lunatic. It was Esau, but it was something about a pile of rocks.
Oh, she was totally telling us about a rock.
What the fuck was it about a pile of rocks? Does anybody remember? Dude, live your life. Live your life.
It's like an Indian burial ground, man.
See, I don't know if this counts. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, my life. You didn't just knock that over. Please tell me you didn't just knock that over.
I just knocked that over.
That's not very nice. Let me put it back. Can't be too careful.
The following night, they hear sticks snapping while they sleep. The next day, they try to hike back to their car but can't find it before day turns to night. They again hear sticks snapping. The next morning, they find three cairns placed beside their tent. Heather finds out her map is missing, and Mike confesses to have kicked the map in the creek out of frustration because they have been walking in these woods for days and can't find the car nor a way out, which provokes a fight between these three characters.
You know what? I kicked the... I'm sorry, it's fucked up. It's fucked up, but I kicked that fucking map into the creek yesterday. It was useless. I kicked that fucker into the creek.
I fucking hope he's kidding.
Wow! Mike? Holy shit!
I really fucking hope
Mike,
he's kidding.
Are you kidding?
I really fucking hope
Mike,
he's kidding.
Are you fucking kidding?
I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry.
You've gotta be kidding me.
Mike,
you have gotta fucking be kidding me!
I'm fucking
you
kidding!
Get the fuck off me, man! What the fuck are you out of your fucking mind?
Oh, I'm not out of my mind!
Mike,
the map doesn't do a shit!
Do you realize? Not to you, but I do! What the fuck that map
fucking
says!
Sorry!
You are a fucking asshole!
I'm sorry!
You're a fucking asshole! And
the
if we,
map wasn't doing shit all day!
If we get hurt or if we die out here, it's your fucking fault! It is your
fucking fault!
Do you understand?
I'm fucking
hurt, I can't believe
I'm
you can be such an asshole! What the fuck were you thinking?
You're fucking with my shit here!
Okay, no, I'm not.
Your
own
map was useless! This was your own map! That map was useless!
You. Okay. Okay.
This is not why I brought you out here, man.
Okay.
I'm sorry about the map, man.
Okay.
What can I say?
Sorry. Please, just don't say sorry. The map was not worth shit to you. I knew exactly where we were on that map.
I
knew exactly where we were on that map!
Yesterday, I asked you what fucking river we were on.
You shut up, or I'm gonna fucking stick your head in
there. Get this fucking camera off.
Give me the compass. You've betrayed us all beyond, way fucking beyond.
Bullshit.
Give me the compass.
You betrayed us when you couldn't get it out of the woods last night.
Yeah, thanks.
Can I hold the fucking compass
now?
Can I hold the fucking compass?
No. I bought the compass. If you wanted a compass, you should have
bought
it.
I don't give a shit if you bought the compass. You fucked us up, he fucked us up. I don't know why you can't admit that you've been screwed from the moment we got out here, man.
Because I haven't. Why are we stopped? Why are we stopped? Does anybody
just
have a...
Just don't.
Does anybody have a reason why we're stopped? That's all I'm asking you. What about the plan to keep going south? We all seemed very happy with that plan. Why is that not a thing anymore?
As they realize they are lost, They decide to go south and find stick figures hanging from trees. They yet again hear mysterious sounds from the forest, including children laughing. After something unknown shakes their tent up at night, they decide to hide in the forest until dawn.
Let me get my jeans on. Take the video camera. No, get the duck ready. Oh, dear God! Oh, dear God!
Go, fucking go!
When they return to the tent, they discover their things have been thrown around and Josh's equipment is also covered with slime. They come across a river, identical to the one they crossed earlier, and realize they have been walking in circles. Josh disappears the next morning, and Heather and Mike try to find him but fail. That night, they hear Josh crying but are unable to find him. They theorize that his yells are a fabrication by the Blair Witch to draw them out of their camp. The next day, Heather discovers a bundle of twigs tied with fabric from Josh's shirt.
Mike,
what?
There's something out here. Okay.
I'm just gonna move it from the front of the tent.
Okay, I'm taking it away. I'm taking it away from the front of the tent. I'm just throwing it. Okay.
We'll just keep walking. Okay?
Okay.
We'll keep walking.
Okay.
I found some cigarettes. I found them all the way at the bottom of my pack. This means we're still alive because we're smoking.
Okay. All full of blood.
Thank you.
Upon opening the bundle, she also finds a blood-soaked scrap of his shirt, containing teeth and hair. Although distraught, she does not tell Mike. That night, she records herself apologizing to her own, Mike's, and Josh's families.
I just want to apologize to Mike's mom and Josh's mom and my mom. And I'm sorry to everyone. I was very naive. I am so sorry for everything that has happened. Because in spite of what Mike says now, it is my fault. Because it was my project. And I insisted. I insisted on everything. I insisted that we weren't lost. I insisted that we keep going. I insisted that we walk south. Everything had to be my way. And this is where we've ended up. And it's all because of me that we're here now. Hungry. And cold. And hunted. I love you, Mom. Scared to close my eyes. I'm scared to open them.
Taking responsibility for their predicament. They again hear Josh's agonized screams and follow them to the abandoned ruins of the House of Rustin Parr, containing demonic symbols and children's bloody handprints on the walls. Trying to locate Josh, they go to the basement, where an unseen force assaults Mike, causing him to drop his camera. Heather enters the basement yelling, and her camera captures Mike standing in a corner facing the wall. Heather calls out to him, but he doesn't react. The unseen force assaults Heather, causing her to drop her camera, and the film ends. The movie was already divided both with audiences and critics, but overall it was an agreement that the movie was an effective effort in the horror genre. To me, this movie is one of the best horror movies ever made, and I will now explain why. The movie is very cerebral, because it doesn't show you the monster in a wide shot and all the details in fully graphic ways. In fact, it doesn't show you the monster at all. But it still manages to be creepy in many parts. You never see the Blair Witch throughout the movie, but the movie has a very good way of making you feel unsettled, and that at any time something can happen. Also, a fun fact about that, when Heather runs and yells at the movie and asks, "What the F is that?" there was a figure that was meant to be showed dressed in white, but the cameraman forgot to pan to the left.
My boots aren't laced. Oh my God, what the fuck is that? What the fuck is that?
And they couldn't do a second take because of the shooting schedule. The movie plays a lot with the relationships of the characters, their panic, and how their demeanor towards each other changes throughout the movie because of them being lost in the middle of nowhere and not finding any way out. You also feel like they are being watched 24/7 as soon as they get lost in the beginning of the movie. Like there is some unseen force out there watching them and almost toying with them before it kills them. The movie is effective because we get to hear this myth about the Blair Witch in the beginning of the movie by people that live in the area. And as the movie continues, all these hints are scattered around in the movie as events that happen to the characters as they are trying to figure out what's going on. The characters themselves, of course, don't believe that there is an actual witch in the woods. So them trying to just get out of the woods and their obvious confusion as to what is going on is very apparent in the dialogue and the actors' performances. I think with how these events and how the story is built up, it is a very captivating story if you have followed everything from the beginning to end. And with an ending that is one of the most chilling endings ever in horror history, this movie makes for one of the strongest horror movies out there. The criticism towards this movie tend to be that there is shaky cam and that the acting is bad. Those arguments kind of feel out of place because this movie is not intended to be seen as a regular movie. It is presented as found footage tapes that were found by the police in the woods that were filmed by film students. So the usual ingredients for how a movie is crafted don't really apply for this movie. Yes, these are actors that are in the movie, but the performances are meant to feel realistic, like it's not a produced movie, but instead just a videotape that was filmed in very random ways with how events happen in the movie. The acting is not meant to feel like a performance in the usual manner, but it's meant to be felt as real reactions and interactions between real people that went missing. The shaky cam is a product of what kind of movie this is. If there were smooth camera movements in this movie, the realism of it would be lost. If the camera movements would have been smooth, it would have had too much of a produced feeling, which would have taken away the effectiveness of the movie and what it is trying to convey. So most of these criticisms from people online just doesn't feel like the movie's intentions were understood. The actors of Heather Donahue, Joshua Leonard, and Michael Williams all didn't have much of an acting career after the smash hit of the Blair Witch Project, partly because of that they didn't take any other acting gigs right after to make the movie seem like it really happened, and partly because it was their first project they did. Heather Donahue had some projects afterwards but called it quits in 2007. Joshua Leonard did stay in Hollywood and is still working as an actor, and he has collaborated with Steven Soderbergh's Unsane and has branched out as a director in some more low-profile projects. Michael Williams is not a full-time actor. He also works as a school counselor and he runs an acting studio with his wife. So some of them have careers in the entertainment industry and some don't, but they will forever be connected to the first Blair Witch movie. The Blair Witch Project was a movie that popularized a whole new subgenre in horror. There was many movies afterwards that tried to do the concept but failed until the first Paranormal Activity movie, which does take influence from the Blair Witch. The found footage genre is very fitting for very low budget movies, but none of them had the marketing strategy, the story, and the very relentless mood like the original Blair Witch movie did. It is still one of my favorite horror movies of all time, and there has been nothing like it, even though many have tried. With the success of the Blair Witch, it was bound to get a sequel, and we got a sequel pretty fast. The year after, we got The Book of Shadows, and for people that thought that this was going to be a straight sequel in the same style, what we got was totally different. This movie, instead of doing it in the found footage style, was made like a conventional movie with new characters, and it is about people that are trying to make money out of the success of the first movie. Here, the characters know that the first movie was fake, and we get a more straightforward movie. The film is contextualized in the beginning blocks of text as a dramatic reenactment of events that occurred after the Blair Witch Project was released into theaters. In November 1999, tourists and fans of the Blair Witch Project descend on the small town of Burkittsville, Maryland, where the film was set. Local resident Jeff, a former psychiatric patient and obsessed fan, orchestrates a group tour of locations featured in the movie. The group are graduate students Steven and his pregnant girlfriend Tristan, who are researching mythology and mass hysteria. Erica the Vicken, daughter of an Episcopal minister, and Kim, a goth with psychic abilities. They camp for the night in the ruins of Rustin Parr's house, where Jeff has placed surveillance cameras, hoping to capture supernatural occurrences. Jeff becomes unnerved when he notices a large tree located in the center of the house's foundation, claiming it was not there before. That night, another tour group arrives to camp at the ruins, but they are misdirected to Coffin Rock by Jeff and Steven. After drinking and smoking marijuana all night, the group awakens in the morning to find Steven and Tristan's research documents shredded and thrown around the woods, and Jeff's cameras destroyed. His damaged tapes are uncovered beneath the house's foundation, the same spot the Blair Witch Project tapes were found in 1995. Tristan suffers a miscarriage, and they rush her to the Burkittsville Hospital. In her hospital room, Tristan sees a young girl walking backwards. After she is discharged, the group retreats to Jeff's home, an industrial building that was once a factory. While Tristan rests, the group reviews Jeff's tapes, which uncover an image of Erica circling around a tree, nude. Distraught, Erica claims she has no memory of such an event and goes to pray in another room. When Kim tries to console her, Erica reveals rash-like symbols covering her body and proclaims the group has been marked for death. Kim borrows Jeff's van to pick up coffee and alcohol in town. At the country store, she gets into an argument with the cashier. While driving away, she swerves to avoid a group of children in the road and crashes the van into a tree, denting the fender. The children disappear when she exits the van. Later, Kim finds a bloody nail file stuck among the bottles of beer she purchased. The following morning, Jeff looks outside and sees the front end of his van entirely caved in, to the point that it is undrivable. Kim insists that the accident was minor. The group realizes Erica is absent and searches the house. They attempt to call her father at his office but are told by his secretary that he has no children. Meanwhile, Tristan's disposition grows increasingly bizarre. The country sheriff Cravens calls Jeff, informing him the other tour group was found disemboweled on Coffin Rock, and threatens him. Later, while searching through a drawer, Kim finds a set of surveillance dossiers on herself and the others. She confronts Jeff, but he denies knowing the source of them. Shortly after, the group discovers Erica's corpse in a closet. Tristan begins chanting about Withershins and speaking backward. This leads Kim to suggest they play Jeff's tapes in reverse. Upon doing so, they find the footage shows the high and drunken group descending into a demonic ritual and frenzied orgy, led by Tristan, culminating in the murder of the other tour group at Coffin Rock. When they confront Tristan, she denies everything. Jeff, convinced Tristan is possessed by the Blair Witch, begins filming the confrontation, attempting to elicit a confession for Eric's death. The three follow Tristan to the second floor, where she ties a rope around her neck and taunts Steven, daring him to push her. In a fit of rage, he pushes her over the balcony, killing her. Later, Jeff, Steven, and Kim are arrested and interrogated by police. Each claimed that a possessed Tristan was responsible. Their accounts are contradicted by various video footage. Security cameras captured Kim murdering the store cashier with her own nail file, while Jeff's home monitors show him nude, hiding Erica's body in the closet. The DV footage Jeff filmed during Tristan's confrontation shows her pleading for her life as they accuse her of being a witch, ending in Steven mercilessly pushing her to her death. Meanwhile, as Jeff, Kim, and Steven are shown this footage by police, Funeral mourners arrive in the woods to remember the other tour group that was murdered. After the massive success of the Blair Witch Project, Arthurson was eager to produce a sequel while the film's popularity was still at its peak. However, Haxham Films, who created the original film, was not ready to begin work on a follow-up, preferring to wait until the initial buzz had died down. In December 1999, Arthurson decided to proceed without them, hiring Joe Berlinger, known for his work on true crime documentaries. This was his first and last narrative film for 19 years to direct. While developing the screenplay, Berlinger spent time in the real town of Burkittsville, the setting of the first Blair Witch Project, undertaking research and interviewing locals on how the release of the film had impacted their lives. Many of the individuals Berlinger interviewed served as a direct inspiration for the characters featured in the film. His core theme when composing the screenplay with Dick Beebe was that the evil attributed to the Blair Witch may be human in origin as opposed to supernatural. Berlinger, the character of Erica, represented an aspect of this, specifically the frustrations that the Wiccan community voiced after the release of the Blair Witch Project, which some felt misconstrued the tenets of Wicca and showed their religion in a negative light. Berlinger was also inspired by the lazy consumption of media that led many to accept that the Blair Witch Project as a true documentary.
It's a very interesting story how I got involved in Blair Witch 2. I would have to say that Blair Witch 2 chose me as opposed to I chose it. I was actually pitching a whole other movie to the executives over at Artisan, and a light bulb sort of went off in their head that maybe I would be an interesting choice to do this movie because I have spent a lot of time as a documentary maker running around the woods of backwoods of America, chasing after evil and dealing with stories of satanic ritual killings. And I guess they thought there might be some connection to what my background is as a real documentary to the heritage of Blair Witch 2. Ironically, I have pushed the movie in a whole other direction and chose purposefully not to shoot it like a documentary because I felt that would be incredibly derivative and unexciting for me and unexciting for audiences. I think the film has a tremendous level of reality and taps into true human fear without resorting to the wonderful production techniques that made the first movie so great. But for me as a documentary maker to just rip off the faux documentary approach of the first movie, I thought would be not the way to go with the sequel. Conceit was brilliant. Of course, I was incredibly jealous at how successful it had become and kept hitting myself over the head. Why didn't I think of that? Because I, as a documentary maker, had a whole room full of the tools of documentary making, and the whole idea of taking the negatives of documentary making and turning them into a positive storytelling approach was absolutely brilliant. But while I was fascinated by the first film, I was actually much more interested in the reaction to the first film. I could understand why people would go into the movie theater thinking that it was a true story because they were given misinformation. They were marketed to in that way over the internet and through other forms of communication that, hey, this is a real story. But clearly, when the movie was over, to me, it was clearly a movie. And the fact that people walked out of the movie still utterly convinced that it was a real story, to the point where they became so obsessed with the Blair Witch Project and its story, thinking it was real, it caused quite a turmoil in the real town of Burkittsville, where the movie was shot. Thousands and thousands of people a week would descend upon that little town of 200 people, demanding to know where the witch was, where the woods are, wanting to know the truth of the Blair Witch legend. And the community had never heard of the Blair Witch because that was a complete invention of the filmmaker.
Specifically, how readily the public is willing to accept that something shot on video is real. He elaborated, on one hand, the Blair Witch 2 works as a standard horror movie, but it is also Meditation on Violence in the Media, and the Nature of Fanatism and Obsession, and the Dangers of Blurring the Lines Between Reality and Fiction. Additionally, Berlinger incorporated elements of real-life subjects and places featured in his 1996 true crime documentary Paradise Lost, The Child Murders at Robin Hood Hills, as well as narrative components of the stage play Six Characters in Search of an Author by Luigi Pirandello. Berlinger based his casting decisions largely on group chemistry between the actors, as the film was anchored exclusively in their collective experience. The casting period only lasted for 6 weeks in New York City. Originally, Tristine Skyler auditioned for the role played by Erica Lurson, while Lurson auditioned for the role played by Kim Director. Upon casting Lurson, who in reality was a short-haired blonde, Berlinger fitted her with hair extensions and had her hair dyed red for the part. Jeffrey Donovan had also originally auditioned for the role played by Stephen Barker Turner, but Berlinger felt him a better fit for the leader of the group. Most of the film was shot over a period of 44 days in the spring of 2000 on location outside of Baltimore, Maryland. The exposition scenes featuring the characters camping were shot in Gwynn Falls, Leakin Park, and the stone ruins of the Rustin Powerhouse were constructed out of styrofoam. The scene featuring Tristan in the hospital was shot at an abandoned sanatorium in Baltimore. Jeff's loft house in the film is actually the Clipper Mill, located on the edge of Baltimore. The documentary footage that opens the film features interviews from real residents of Burkittsville, Maryland. Because the original film had been parodied so much since its release, Berlinger deliberately avoided using any shaky camera work and the stylistic cliches of bad documentary filmmaking, opting to maintain an aesthetic at odds with the documentary form. Stylistically, Book of Shadows was the direct opposite of its predecessor. Though the film occasionally utilizes the point of view camcorder pseudo documentary format used in the first movie, Book of Shadows more closely resembles the glossy big budget special effects Latin horror films that Blair Witch was a counter to. Berlinger has stated that he originally made the film with more of an ambiguous tone that focused on the characters' psychological unraveling after their night spent in the Black Hills. But Artisan forced him to recut the film and reshoot certain scenes to add more traditional horror movie elements, thus creating what they saw as a more commercial film. Namely, the footage of the main characters murdering the foreign tourists was shot in Berlinger's backyard mere weeks prior to the film's release date and was incorporated in the film as flash cuts to add more visual violence. Furthermore, expository footage showing Jeff in a psychiatric hospital was also shot at the request of Artisan executives. These scenes were filmed at the Kirby Forensics Psychiatric Center on Randall's Island in New York City. Berlinger later stated that he felt the gory sequences incorporated into the film fought against the ambiguity he tried to nurture. Additionally, the interrogation sequences, which are intercut throughout the film, were, per Berlinger's director's cut, arranged as a single 8-minute long sequence, bookending the film. Instead, the studio requested Berlinger cut the sequence into isolated vignettes and intercut them throughout the film. This compromised Berlinger's original vision of a linear narrative that begins as a light-hearted romp in the woods, almost as a spoof of the Blair Witch phenomenon, before descending into a downward spiral. The original cut of the film also featured Frank Sinatra's Witchcraft during the opening credits, but was replaced by the studio with Disposable Teens by Marilyn Manson. Multiple fan edits have since attempted to reconstruct Berlinger's original vision. So this movie was panned when it came out in 2000. And I have to agree, this movie was made very fast to bank on the success of the first movie. And what we get is a very big mess. The story is kind of non-existent. There is a smart, self-aware story in this, but the execution is lagging, which makes me think that the director didn't get to do the movie he wanted to do. The story and characters are so uninteresting that you don't get any attachment for any of them. The story is comprised of random scenes where we get different visions from the characters, and it vaguely is connected to the witch from the first movie. So from the beginning of the movie, we basically get random events that lead up to the end. Nothing is really connected throughout the story, and this movie is a disgrace to the first movie. We would have to wait 16 years until we got something that respected the first movie and had the elements that made the first one so successful. With this movie, the director Adam Wingard wanted to pay respect to the original movie. The creative team even tried to be creative with the marketing like the first one was, but in a different way. The trailer for Blair Witch 2016 was presented as The Woods. And from the trailer, it looked a lot like The Blair Witch, or that it was a movie that was very inspired by The Blair Witch Project. The first audiences even went into the movie with posters saying The Woods, and went in to see it, and then when they came out, the posters had been changed into The Blair Witch. Then, after those first audiences came, they actually did change the trailer too, into calling it Blair Witch. So this was a way of trying to recreate the marketing of the first movie, but in a very different way. Instead of making the movie seem like real found footage, it was hidden that the movie was a sequel to the Blair Witch Project. The movie overall is good, with some parts here and there that are not used to their full potential, like the addition of drones, and there are too many jump scares throughout the movie, while also redoing the ending of the original movie. Other than that, this movie expands upon the lore of the Blair Witch franchise. Most of the characters are fun, and the story is a well-told one. The best parts of it is how it expands the lore of the Blair Witch universe. It's a sequel that has a function in the franchise and adds elements to the lore. We also get a glance of creatures that people were first thinking it was the Blair Witch herself. But the production team denied that you ever see the actual Blair Witch in the movie. In 2014, James Donahue finds a video on YouTube containing an image of a woman he believes to be his sister Heather, who disappeared in 1994 near Burkittsville, Maryland, while investigating the legend of the Blair Witch. He decides to travel to the woods to find out the truth. Accompanied by his friend Peter Jones, Peter's girlfriend Ashley Bennett, and film student Lisa Arlington, who wants to film James' search as a documentary. The absence of closure. Locals Talia and Lane, who found and uploaded the video, say they will show the group the location that they found the tape, on the condition that they can join them. While walking through the woods and upon setting up camp for the night, Lane and Talia discuss the disappearance of Heather and her film crew, the 1940-41 murders by Rostin Parr, and other mysterious occurrences, which they ascribe to the Blair Witch. Specifically, Lane explains that the witch was not just left tied to a tree to die, instead tied high up in the tree with weights on her arms and legs to act as a makeshift torture rack. The group hear noises during the night, then awaken at 2 p.m. to find strange stick figures hanging from the trees.
Oh my God!
When Lisa notices twine in Lane's backpack, he and Talia admit to creating the figures in order to convince the group to believe, but also point out that there is no explanation for the strange noises during the night and sleeping through the day. James and his associates banish Lane and Talia from the group and head out of the woods. After hours of walking, the four arrive back at their original campsite. Lisa pilots a drone to obtain their location, but from its vantage point, they can see no way out of the forest. Ashley becomes sick due to a wound on her foot, forcing the group to camp again. When Peter inspects Ashley's wounded foot, he notices what he thinks may be a parasite inside the wound. Peter leaves the camp for firewood and is chased by an unknown entity. A tree falls on him and his body then disappears. Lane and Talia appear in the night, claiming they have been wandering for 5 days without the sunrise. Lane believes the camp is a hallucination and runs off, leaving the disheveled and hungry Talia. The next morning, James and Lisa find that it is still dark outside at 7 a.m. and discover larger stick figures. Talia sees clumps of her hair tied to one of the figures. Ashley accuses Talia of crafting them and snaps the figure with Talia's hair in half. Talia herself is then snapped in half. An unseen force lifts their tent into the sky and the group is separated. Ashley finds the drone and climbs a tree to recover it, but is knocked out and falls from the tree, an unknown entity dragging her away. A rainstorm ensues as Lisa and James stumble across Rustin Parr's house, which James had previously stated to have been burned down after Parr's execution. James hears someone he thinks is Heather scream upstairs, enters the house without Lisa, and sees Peter standing in a corner. He chases after the figure he believes to be Heather.
Heather!
Teleporting the disheveled figure upon its vanishing, he barricades himself. Lisa spots a tall, pale, long-limbed creature moving through the trees, and she runs inside the house. She enters the basement where she finds a hostile Lane who traps her in a tunnel, saying, "You have to do what she tells you." She escapes the tunnel and stabs and kills Lane on the other side. The long-limbed creature emerges from the tunnel and chases Lisa. She runs up the attic with Lane's camcorder, passing a mirror that shows Heather, revealing that the tape found by Lane is actually the one being recorded by Lisa, creating the paradox video that lured them all to the woods. She reunites with James in the attic, and they try to barricade the door, A bright light shines from outside the building. James tells Lisa to face the corner of the room and desperately apologizes to her before something enters the room. James is tricked into turning around, believing that he hears Heather's voice, and vanishes from sight. Lisa realizes she will die if she turns around, so she uses Lane's camcorder to view what is behind her and begins walking backward. She thinks she hears James' voice and turns to look, whereupon she is snatched away. Her camera falls to the ground. After a few moments, the camera gives out. While promoting VHS 2 in 2013 at the Sundance Film Festival, director Adam Wingard and writer Simon Barrett ran into original The Blair Witch Project 1999 co-filmmaker Eduardo Sanchez and producer Greg Hale and asked them why there were not any more Blair Witch films. Although nothing came out of the meeting at the time, a few months later, Wingard and Barrett were asked to meet with Lionsgate Films to potentially work on a secret project. Barrett recalled that in the initial pitch meeting, Lionsgate had already crafted a story for a new Blair Witch film and simply asked if they would be interested in making it. Barrett said that the only thing I really pitched was the other characters. They'd originally conceived the film as more similar to the first film, following its narrative fairly closely, with only three or four characters, I think. But I wanted more characters to give us more scare sequences. I also wanted a unique dynamic within the group from the start, so I pitched the idea of introducing some Burkittsville locals to the group. Barrett would later note that the team found the found footage genre more challenging, as they have only previously worked with the anthology films VHS. Barrett noted that the VHS series, there was an inherent entertainment value, where the segments were never meant to feel entirely real, an element that did not work for the Blair Witch series. Speaking on the issue to Bloody Disgusting, Barrett said that even if our scares didn't work in VHS, hopefully people would still be entertained, and if they weren't, well, another short would start in a few minutes. He added that if a scare did not work in Blair Witch, we'd have nothing to fall back on. We just have failed completely and publicly. To prevent this from happening, Barrett and Wingard extensively went over each scare to discover why it was scary and how the audience would react to it. For some sequences, multiple approaches were tried differently to give them options in the editing room. Principal photography took place in the spring of 2015 in a set of woods in British Columbia in Canada. Scenes taking place in the famous Blair Witch House were shot in a soundstage, where the house was entirely rebuilt. Blair Witch 2016 grossed $20.8 million in North America and $24.4 million in other territories, for a worldwide total of $45.2 million. Against a production budget of $5 million. In the United States and Canada, the film was released on September 16, 2016, and was initially projected to gross at least $20 million, with a chance to get as high as $26 million in its opening weekend. Lionsgate's expectations were more conservative, however, with a projected $15 to $18 million opening, although rival studios were predicting significantly higher numbers, noting how horror films saw solid performances throughout 2016, including Lights Out, The Conjuring 2, The Purge election year, The Shallows, and Don't Breathe. It ended up grossing $9.7 million in its opening weekend, below expectations and the lowest opening weekend of the series. The film was considered a box office disappointment. The film cost $5 million to produce, with an additional $20 million spent on promotion, advertising, and marketing costs. When it comes to any new content being made in this franchise, there is a new movie being planned, directed by Oliver Park, who has directed some horror shorts over the years. The movie is once again being produced by Lionsgate, and my expectations are quite high for it because I honestly think there is a lot you can do with this franchise and this lore. It would be interesting to see a period movie set when Ellie Kedward was convicted of being a witch and how all that played out, but at the same time it would take away the mystery. I also think you can do a lot with the time-changing aspects presented in the 2016 movie. All in all, I am excited to see what Lionsgate comes up with for the new movie, and we will have to wait and see. What I like the most about the first movie and the 2016 sequel is that it is actually scary, supernatural horror, with well-defined lore. It is an interesting concept that you get lost in the woods and can't get out, and that the time changes, day becomes night, just because the witch wants to mess with you. It's a scary thought to be lost in a time vortex, where objects change, places change, the time moves differently. That is ultimately why I think the original and the 2016 movie are so scary. This has been Boogeyman Cinema. Thank you for watching.